Hi, thanks for having me. My name is Greg Capareso. I'm going to talk a little bit today about a package that my lab has been working on in collaboration with a few other labs called scikit-bio. And this is a Python package that's designed for building core bioinformatics data structures and algorithms in Python. And I first want to talk just a little bit about the prehistory of scikit-bio, and I apologize that the font is a little bit small up there. But this has really evolved out of about 10 years of bioinformatics Python software development. So some folks that have been around for a while in this area might remember a couple packages called PyEvolve and PyCogent. These essentially represent projects that were developed by myself, by Rob Knight, and by a collaborator in Australia, Gavin Huntley. And essentially, we're an earlier incarnation of this, of trying to build these core data types and algorithms in Python for bioinformatics. And these spawned a number of tools over the years, the most significant of which is probably the Chime software package, or the most widely known as the Chime software package. And so Chime stands for Quantitative Insights into Microbial Ecology. If you believe Google Scholar, it's been cited about 1,600 times since we published it in Nature Methods. And the reason I'm bringing it up now is that I just want to mention that this has had a big impact on the field. So this is for studying communities of microorganisms, such as those that live in and on the human body or out in the environment. And so this has been widely used, is making a big impact, so you can see it's being published or cited in places like Science, Nature, PNAS on a regular basis. And so the goal of scikit-bio is really to make it easier, to build the framework to make it easier to build tools like Chime, so to build tools that are going to have a big impact on human medicine and on basic biology research and on environmental microbiology. And the way that we're doing that, and the reason that we wanted to start from the ground up with this package rather than continue to build off of things like PyCogent, is that there's been so much amazing development in Python scientific computing over the last decade that we found when we got started on this, when we started thinking about refactoring some of our existing tools, that it was going to be easier and better to do this from scratch and taking the lessons that we learned from all of these pre-existing software packages to build a new bioinformatics Python package. And so when I say making use of these modern tools, I'm thinking about all of the things that everybody in this room knows and loves, like SciPy and NumPy and IPython. And also adopting what we're thinking of as sort of the modern community standards for Python packages. And so that includes things like adhering to the NumPy API documentation standards, going for full PEP8 compliance. So all of our code in scikit-bio is full PEP8 compliant. We include test coverage in our continuous integration. So we've got 99% test coverage. And we know if any, say, pull request is going to reduce that test coverage. And so we can monitor that and make sure that we're maintaining high code or high test coverage. We have native support for Python 2, Python 3, and then everything else that we all love, hosted on GitHub, continuous integration testing with Travis, peer-reviewed code via pull requests, BSD license, and so on. So what is it that we're actually implementing here? So like I said, core objects and algorithms for bioinformatics. And so this includes basic objects, so things like DNA sequence objects, RNA sequence objects, and you can do things with those like translate them into proteins or load them into sequence collections and align them and generate alignment objects. You can build phylogenetic trees using things like neighbor joining. And so this is just sort of a short list of some of the functionality that's in there from the API reference on our website. Documentation site is listed up there at the top. In addition to these objects and algorithms, we also are implementing some statistical methods that are relevant here but not present in other places like SciPy because they're very bioinformatics focused. And so an example of something like that would be metrics for computing alpha diversity or beta diversity for studying biological diversity. So something like the FAITH phylogenetic diversity metric would be implemented in scikit-bio, but probably not in in a tool like SciPy. One of the other things that really drove us to start building this from the ground up is that we wanted a software package that was both education-ready and production-ready. And I'm going to describe what I mean by the combination of those terms. So when I say education ready, probably the biggest point that exemplifies that is that we're building this in the context of a Creative Commons IPython notebook-based introductory bioinformatics text. And that's called an Introduction to Applied Bioinformatics, and that's primarily being developed in my lab and over the course of teaching some introductory undergraduate and graduate bioinformatics courses over the last 3 years. And so what this does, you can find this at appliedbioinformatics.org, but here's just a quick screenshot that shows some of the content of this book. And so in this particular case, I'm talking about an idea. I'm talking about progressive iterative multiple sequence alignment. And so we have some nice omnigraphal figures in there that show exactly how this process works. And then we have some discussion of the concepts. But we're presenting all of these concepts in the context of the source code for actually running those, so the source code for those algorithms. And that source code comes from scikit-bio. And so what we're able to do is teach students the concepts in the context of the tools that they would actually be using this when they leave your class and go on to develop their own bioinformatics pipelines. And so I mentioned that we're following the NumPy API documentation standards, and so this format probably looks familiar to anybody who's used that or who's adhering to that. And this is just one example where I'm looking at a local pairwise align function, and this is a pure Python implementation of Smith-Waterman. And we use this primarily for educational purposes here, but you can see a new user or a student in your class can just use some IPython magic here and get the detailed API documentation. And so they can learn what parameters that takes, what it returns. They could also use the IPython psource command to look at the source code for that right in the context of the notebook. And that's what we do in these notebooks when we're teaching about an algorithm. And of course, all that documentation is available on the web too. And so this is just an HTML rendering of that same API documentation. So your student can then take these aligners, they can use IPython magic to learn how to use them, say for a homework assignment, and they can apply these. And one of the things you'll notice here is that when I apply this local align function, I'm getting this big pink warning message in the IPython notebook. And what this is telling me is that this is essentially a scikit-bio efficiency warning. And it's telling us that we're using a slow implementation of Smith-Waterman. It's telling us the code that you're using here is not production ready. And it's suggesting that you use a different implementation of this. It's saying you should go use local pairwise align SSW instead. And what that local pairwise align SSW is it's a Cython wrapper for a C implementation of Stripe Smith-Waterman. This is, SSW is the fastest open source Stripe Smith-Waterman implementation. And we make that available with the exact same interface, or, you know, to the degree possible, we have like slight name in the function. But what you can then do is you can use the Python implementations to teach about these concepts, and they're going to be accessible in your introductory bioinformatics courses. And you can investigate that code, and your students can look at it, and they can learn how the code works. And then when they move on and they go to build their own real-world bioinformatics pipelines, all they have to do is change a function name, and they're using the same interfaces, and maybe they don't have the technical expertise to really go in and understand that code like they can the Python code. But what you can see here is if we compare these two, the only difference in these calls is the function call, or sorry, is the function name. And this Stripe Smith-Waterman, as you would expect, is about 4,000 or 5,000 times faster than the native Python implementation. And so they learn about the tools in Python, and then they can apply the production-ready tools. And so that's essentially what I mean when I say that scikit-bio is both education-ready and production-ready. Okay, so one of the other things that we are really striving for with scikit-bio is making bioinformatics pipeline development easy. And I'm just going to work through a couple demos here now just to show you a little bit of the functionality that's in scikit-bio. And what I'm going to do here, so I mentioned that Chime is a very widely used bioinformatics package, and this beta diversity through plots script in Chime is probably the most widely used workflow in the Chime software package. And because I wrote that, I can say this, it's actually a little bit clunky. It would be pretty hard for somebody other than me to go in there and adapt it and make it do some new bioinformatics workflow. And making that type of thing easier to do is one of the main things that motivated building scikit-bio. And I'm not going to, right now, I'm not going to get too into a conceptual discussion of what's going on in this demo. That's actually the role of the Introduction to Applied Bioinformatics textbook. And so if you want to learn more about this demo that I'm doing right now, just check out the Studying Biological Diversity chapter in that book. So the demo that I'm going to walk you through is focused on studying the human microbiome. And so the human microbiome is the literally trillions of microorganisms that live in and on the human body, and that we're learning over the past decade or so play a huge role in human health. And so what I'm doing here is I've just put a very small demo data set together where I'm I've taken human microbial community samples, six human microbial community samples. And I did this from two subjects, and so we have subjects one and two, and for each subject we did that from three body sites. So we did that from the gut, from the skin, and from the tongue. And ultimately, what I want to do here, the question that I want to answer in this demo is, are samples that are derived from the same subject, so from the same human, more similar to each other than samples that are derived from different humans? And so when we're comparing the similarity of these samples, what we're really looking at here, and this is all in a pandas data frame, what we're looking at here is for each one of our samples, so we have samples A, B, C, D, E, E, and F, and if we go back to the sample metadata, you can see this is these subjects from their different body sites. We have what I would call a taxonomic profile of each of these samples, and so we see bacterial species 1 is present, has a count of 23, and bacterial species 2 has a count of 64 in sample A. And so what we want to do is compare these taxonomic profiles and figure out if the ones from the same subjects are more similar to each other. And so using scikit-bio and using SciPy under the hood, it's really easy for us to compute pairwise distances between the samples. So I'm importing from scikit-bio's beta diversity module a function called pw_distances for pairwise distances. This is a light wrapper around SciPy's pw_dist function, I think it's called. And we can pass in these two pandas data frames, just in this case, it's just one pandas data frame, so it is those taxonomic profiles on a per subject basis, or per sample basis, and we can run the Bray-Curtis pairwise distance metric on those, and what we get back is a scikit-bio distance matrix object. You know, maybe in this case where you've got six samples, you can squint at this and you can kind of figure out what's going on, what are the most similar and what are the most dissimilar of these samples. But in most cases, we're actually looking at thousands of samples here. And so you can't really look at a 1,000 by 1,000 distance matrix and get a feeling for what's going on. And so what Chime users of this workflow next typically want to do is an ordination. And so using scikit-bio's principal coordinates analysis implementation, it's just essentially one line of code there to do an ordination. And then we just pulled this plotting code from the matplotlib gallery. And so it's really quick to just plug this in and get a principal coordinates plot out of that, a 3D principal coordinates plot. And so what I'm doing in this plot here is I'm coloring each of these points. So each of these points represents a sample, and I'm coloring each one of them by the subject that it was derived from. And so it looks like, based on this, we can answer our question. So remember, the question was, are the samples from the same subject more similar to each other than samples from different subjects? And based on this plot, it looks like the answer to that is no. So subject 1 is in purple, subject 2 is in yellow. And so you can see, like, these purple and yellow are clustering together, these purple and yellow are clustering together. And so we don't see the samples clustering by subject. If we instead look at some of the other metadata that we had in that sample metadata table, what we can look at here is the other metadata category, which was body site. And so in this case, we can color the samples by whether they're derived from the tongue, whether they're derived from the gut, or whether they're derived from the skin. And what we can see now is that these samples do cluster by the body site that they came from. And so the way that we interpret that is that, for example, the microbial community that's living in my mouth is going to be more similar to the microbial community that's living in your mouth than it is to the microbial community that's living on my hand. And so in other words, it's the body site that's driving the composition of these communities. And the Chime workflow doesn't end there. We just sort of got a visual, we did some visual inspection of these results, but the next thing you would want to do is some statistical analysis. And so using scikit-bio's Enosim functionality, we can essentially do some statistics to see whether there's significant clustering by subject. And we do that up here, and we find that there's not. And we can then do that by body site, and we find that there is clustering by body site. And so essentially what this, what these steps have allowed us to do is recreate this entire Chime workflow in about 10 API calls. And again, as the author of the original Chime workflow, it's much bigger than that. It would be much harder to assemble this into some novel pipeline. And so scikit-bio is really enabling us to build these very powerful, very flexible bioinformatics pipelines. And we also have focused a lot on API documentation. And so this entire example that I just worked through is actually part of our doc-tested module-level documentation for beta diversity. And so this is from up on the website, and you're guaranteed that this is going to work. It's all doc-tested every time there's a commit, every time there's a pull request. And so what you can do is you can go here, you can copy this code, you can paste it into your IPython notebook, and then get it working, and then adapt it for your own purposes. I want to show one more example while we're here. And I think, first of all, this is a fun example. Second of all, I think it does a good job of showing the generalizability of scikit-bio. And so I picked this example for a couple reasons. So number one, because I travel a lot. Number two, I like beer. And so I thought this was a nice example. And the question that I was interested in here was whether we could use these same tools that we use for studying the relationships between organisms to study the evolutionary relationship between human language. And so what I did here was I went out on the web and I compiled a list of how to order a beer in about 40 different languages. And so you can see, like, what I've got in this list of tuples is the language, then the spelling of the phrase for ordering a beer in that language, and then over on the end is a phonetic representation of that. And so what I can do here is I can take these phrases and I can do a global alignment of those phrases and I can compute the distance between them. So for example here, I'm computing the distance, I'm doing a global alignment, full Needleman-Wunsch alignment of the phrase for ordering a beer in Swedish and Norwegian. And you can see this is my alignment here and this is the Hamming distance between those phrases. And if I scroll down here, I can do Swedish and Icelandic. And so we are immediately seeing some intuitive results here. So this is telling us that Swedish and Norwegian are closer to each other than Swedish and Icelandic. And if we scroll down to the bottom, I'm doing Spanish and Italian. And so if we take these together, what that tells us is that Spanish and Italian are closer to each other than Swedish and Icelandic, but not as close to each other as Swedish and Norwegian. And I can even take this one step further and just compute all pairwise distances. I can get the scikit-bio distance matrix coming back from that. And then with a little bit of SciPy magic, I can build a phylogenetic tree representing the relationships between these languages. And so like what we can see here is, remember these are phonetic, these are based on phonetic representations. And so we see that there is some difference between say Spanish in Spain and Spanish in Latin America, though they are very close and their nearest neighbor is Portuguese. Norwegian and Swedish are very close, Icelandic is right near them, and so I was pretty amazed that this actually worked based on, you know, just one phrase, but I also thought this was interesting because it shows just sort of how general this functionality is and some of the flexibility that we could have in applying this. Okay, so where are we and where are we going? So we're currently, scikit-bio, we consider to be pre-alpha release stage right now. So we're very much at the point where we're trying to define the scope of this project. We're trying to figure out what we want to include. We're trying to figure out how best to build this package. And we're very interested in getting input from the community. In fact, that's why we're here this week, is to present these, but also to learn about what everybody else is working on. And I actually have four of the scikit-bio developers here with me, so if you guys could just stand up for a minute and give a wave. These are all, between the five of us, we're some of the core developers on the scikit-bio package. And we're gonna be here all week. We're planning to sprint over the weekend with other people, so we're specifically not sprinting on scikit-bio this year, but we wanna get involved in other people's sprints and learn how you guys do them. So we regularly hold code sprints, maybe about once every 3 months to work on this and some of our other software packages, but we're here to learn and get involved in other people's packages this week. And so I just want to wrap up by acknowledging some of the contributors. And so up on the top here, these are the folks that have contributed to scikit-bio itself. And then the second block down here are folks that have contributed to the prehistory of scikit-bio, so some of the other packages that I mentioned in the beginning. And this is just a photo from one of our first scikit-bio code sprints in Flagstaff, Arizona. And so a couple of these folks are here in the room with us. And so again, if you have any questions, come find us this week. We're really interested in wider community involvement. I will leave you guys with some of our awesome ASCII art and take any questions you might have.